Bro, what the fuck? Whoa!
Yeah. Oh, pain. Oh, pain. Oh, pain. Oh, pain. Oh, pain.
Yeah.
Hey. Huh. I just wanna touch the top, baby. Said that she in love, and she don't love the lie. I've been chilling with all the bros. I've been above the spot. Shawty said that things change, well it does a lie. Hey, watching out the payment, man, the suds is high. Yeah, lost inside the heart, but it's emerging, right? I've been out the way, and I'm good. I can find my home. Everything I said it was is not. Yeah, Jamaica, how you laying? Yeah, you ain't say no, what you saying, baby? I lost you, but who's paying? Don't know why you hit my phone. Yeah, I can see the top, I wanna touch it, yeah. We been getting money, no discussion. I don't let it talk, but shorty always get the fussy, yeah. Ayy, I like the cruise on it. Say she like the way I sound and how I groove on him. I been steady dodging bullets, how I move on him. But he talking out his neck and not a crew on him, yeah. And I'm sliding. Shorty like the vibe, don't want the ride to end, yeah. To the nice end, yeah. To the nice end, I can always keep the cool, I'm never fighting. Man, our love was all the cake without the icing. Now I found new love, different pricing. And it won't cause my soul, no devices. Yeah, I ain't got a plan for it, I'm the man for it. Selling Brody couldn't stand for it, it's very important. I've been off the edge, I've been feeling the wind blowing. I can lose my head and my heart, but they've been gone. I just hit the edge of stairs when it's dead time. I just lost promises, I regret mine. I just get a lot of love on the west side. I'm the goat, but I will never be the best guy. You might take me out of business like I'm Best Buy. Talk about the goat, or maybe soon, I don't know.
Ride the Tide Sports Podcast is brought to you by Vegas Sports Advantage.
Welcome to VegasSportsAdvantage.com, the website where you can win with us. It doesn't matter if your favorite team is playing. What matters is which team has the best odds to win. Our MIT team has had a winning record every year for the past 15 years. This gives us the confidence to guarantee all of our packages. We have the highest verified record. Don't miss out. Get in the game. It doesn't matter which sport it is. Win with Vegas Sports Advantage. Go to VegasSportsAdvantage.com to start winning today.
Well, welcome to the pre-show, to the pre-show for Super Bowl Sunday, otherwise known as Season 2, Episode 6 of Ride the Tide Spodcast.
Spodcast. You almost had it, man. You almost had it.
One word away! I can do this, right, though. I'm excited.
Close, but that's no Tycho. Cigars.
Fuck, I can't. That's
you can't.
That's Noob Luke. Jesus. Someone else.
You're having a drop the having a fucking day. Ball.
Drop the ball completely.
No, I was all right. 50%.
Well, Dylan completely botched that, but welcome to Ride the Tide Sports Podcast, Season 2, Episode 6, also known as Super Bowl Sunday episode. I know I'm excited.
That's
We've been waiting 2 weeks for some really good football. And we're finally here, Super Bowl Sunday, Rams and Bengals. It all comes down to this. Matthew Stafford, whether you love him or you hate him, we're going to watch him on Sunday. Today, we're going to see whether or not he's built for this, you know, whether or not he was the missing piece the Rams needed and whether or not he can really do
is
it. He can come up clutch.
That guy.
We're gonna find out, but
I hope he is.
We do have some Super Bowl Sunday to talk about. So what I want to do is a little bit of a Super Bowl same game parlay bets here. I have three different same game parlay bets. All the odds are provided by FanDuel Sportsbook, just a sportsbook that I've been using. So we're gonna use FanDuel Sportsbook's odds for the same game parlay. So we're gonna go around these three, and I just want to know If you guys were going to build a parlay, what are your picks for these games? So we're going to get into the Super Bowl same game parlay bets in just a second.
All right. Well, first thing.
Well, that was not the right thing.
I was like, what?
That's an old clip. That's an old clip. I didn't mean to click that.
No.
So, anytime touchdown scores. I got all the anytime touchdown score prop bets listed on the bottom of the screen. So, you can pick as many as you want or as few as you want, but they're all going to count towards whatever, like, you know, I'm going to keep track of them here. We're going to see who does the best percentage-wise or profit-wise, I guess, in the Super Bowl. Or whether or not, I guess, your parlay hits. So, We'll see what happens. I'll see the odds. I'll get the odds on FanDuel. We'll actually make the parlays. But we're gonna start with anytime touchdown scores. So I guess we'll start with Dylan. Anytime touchdown score.
Burrow and Stafford are +700 and +800. I would take one of them to get a rushing touchdown, man. I feel like it's unexpected, but at the same time, they're both mobile enough to where it's not out of the picture. So I could definitely see one of them getting a rushing touchdown. If I had to go one or the other, I'm going to go with Joe Burrow. But at any time touchdown score, the two people that I 100% seeing at any point getting in the end zone are Cooper Kupp and Jamar Chase. I'm not making anything crazy, but those are the two locks. Not the better here.
Luke, what do you got? Anytime touchdown score bets in the same game parlay.
All right, you ready for it?
I'm ready.
I got Kupp, Mixon, Chase, Beckham. I got
four.
Rams D.
Oh.
What?
I got Higgins.
What?
What?
Boom.
Oh my God, I just drop a bomb on the people like that. Cooper Kupp, Joe Mixon, Jamar Chase, OBJ, the Rams defense, and T. Higgins all getting a touchdown in the Super Bowl. Okay, Luke.
We're having a game.
He's just like okay, Jesse, though. Luke. They think there's going to be 60 points scored in this bitch.
They really do. But, all right, my same game parlay, my anytime touchdown scores in this game, I'm going to go with Odell Beckham Jr. for a touchdown, Joe Mixon for a touchdown, and I'm gonna pick one more. Give me Matthew Stafford on a rushing touchdown. Give me that. You know, I'm pretty sure Matthew Stafford has the worst odds to get a touchdown, but no, I want Matthew Stafford in the end zone, freaking spiking the ball and screaming his nuts off because go Stafford.
If you want a safe bet, you want a little bit riskier bet. If you want a fucking complete ballsy bet, that's where you're looking at.
All right, let's go. Let's go talk about some just regular prop bets here. I just want to know, you got to pick just one or the other here. All right. So, Matthew Stafford over under 283.5 passing yards as listed on FanDuel Sportsbook.
Over. I don't even think that most of the yards are going to be him hucking it down the field. I just think a lot of the short passes with Cooper Kupp and OBJ when they break open in back of the field, that's going to just keep counting for his yard total. I think he'll have at least 200 passing yards.
Luke, what do you think?
You know, I think he hits because I have a single game parlay made in MGM of him going over 279.5 passing yards.
Luke, how much money are you throwing on this Super Bowl?
Luke, I need more. I need a little bit more of an analysis than you're going to say yes because you have it in another parlay. Why do you think he's going to do that? Why'd you make the first bet?
Well, you're not going to like the answer to that because I made that bet on Madden.
Is all of this stemming analytical just because of Madden? So why did you make that bet on Madden? Like, what do you think is going to make him?
Because he's going to be down the field.
Jesus,
that's exactly more of what I was looking for. I have to agree. I think Matthew Stafford is going to get a couple of those long passes, whether it's to Cooper Kupp, who is supposed to be covered by the Rams, or not the Rams, it's Bengals' best coverage guy. And he's one of the best cornerbacks in the league. I can't remember his name to save my life right now.
Eli
Apple. But I don't know if that's what I'm talking about. Eli Apple is not very good. There's a different guy. But he's going to be covering Cooper Kupp. You'll know it when you see him. They'll probably talk about it, but he's one of the best in the league. But I think he can get it to Van Jefferson or OBJ on a deep route. They have so many weapons that I think he's definitely bound for 300-plus yards. So I'm going to take the over 283.5. All right, the last prop bet we have here, Joe Burrow, over under 1.5 passing touchdowns in this game. Dylan.
Yeah, I would put 2 at the minimum. Because I see Jamar Chase getting in the end zone at some point this game. It's very hard for me to not. And then you have Tyler Boyd. Ozuma's going to play. T. Higgins. Yeah, I think that one of those three will definitely get in the end zone. Even if it's a test, go missing.
Luke, what do you got?
Hammer the over.
It's not what Luke wants. It's what he needs, all right?
No, I get it. And I support it. I do. I'm going to take the over. I think that the only way the Bengals stay in this game is not going to be with rushing the ball because their offensive line is not it, and it's going to have to be through the air. So give me Joe Burrow over 1.5 passing touchdowns. I think he gets probably at least 3. And that does it for the Super Bowl same game parlay bets. That was solid, boys. That was solid.
I'm happy.
But we do have some more NFL to talk about. We do. We got some NFL awards. The NFL awards ceremony happened. And I also do want to mention something about this year's MVP because his speech sounded a lot like a speech that I would give to my workplace if I was never coming back. So let's talk about that one first. Aaron Rodgers wins the MVP, and his speech consisted of him basically saying, thank you for 17 really good years. You know, you're a great coach, all this and that. And it really sounded to me like Aaron Rodgers was talking about like he was leaving Green Bay. What do you guys think?
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to be honest. I agree 100%. I don't know how the hell I got myself into watching the entire NFL honors, but I did. And I was primarily waiting for this moment because of this speech. Because Rodgers is really fucking cryptic with what he says nowadays with the COVID and what he's going to do. And, you know, he's not really big on, he'll tell you one thing, he'll just kind of give you a clue. So in his speech, when he starts saying exactly everything that Tyler said, I'm sitting over here laughing. I think it's great because it's almost like he's saying, I finished on an MVP, finished on a back-to-back, couldn't have had any better, and now I get to go. I think he deserved the MVP, to be honest. I know there's a lot of Cooper Kupp people that are mad because, you know, this and that, but I feel you. I was in that boat with Derrick Henry last year. It's a QB game, and that's the way that it works. And I think Rodgers does well-deserved MVP. Snoop.
Well, I mean, had a shit first game. Shit start to the season. Didn't throw any interceptions the rest of the season. So, deserves it.
I guess that's fair enough. Straight to the point. But Aaron Rodgers did sound like he was on his way out, and I think it'd be very interesting and very, very great for the Lions if he could just leave this division. That'd be great. I would love that.
I would love that tremendously. But there were a lot of other awards, and the next award we can get into right now is the one that Tal's going to put on the screen, which is Cooper Kupp being named the Offensive Player of the Year. I'm going to be honest. You can say whatever you want. This bitch wasn't close. You're going in there as a receiver. You're going to win the Triple Crown. You're most likely going to win Offensive Player of the Year. And he did. The voting was not close for this award really at all. Cooper Kupp won it over Jonathan Taylor, which is the only other person that anyone else could have saw winning this award. But if I'm being honest, Jonathan Taylor wouldn't have even been the top contender if Derrick Henry had a full year. And that's not even me saying that off a Derrick Henry bias fan. I'm just saying off the numbers when he got injured. That's the only reason why I think he was even in that combo.
Yeah. I also hope Derrick Henry comes back real, real, real good next year because,
well,
you know, with that shit in his foot, I think you know, they were saying he came back too early in that playoff game. He didn't really look that effective. So well, hopefully he has good rehab this offseason.
They interviewed him at the NFL Honors, and he was wearing, like, the sunglasses because his eyes, he looked mad. And they were like, "What? Like, why do you seem so unhappy?" And he said, "I'm just pissed off to be here. I'm pissed off that the fact that Cincinnati's in the Super Bowl means we could have been in the Super Bowl." And bro was just angry. He wanted to get back on the field. He said he wasn't going to be happy, not a single day going by, until he's back in an NFL game. That's the mentality I want to hear, bro. I'm going to be honest. Wake up every day pissed off because of that shit. I'm pissed off, too. The fact that Cincinnati's in the Super Bowl and the Tennessee Titans are not makes me fucking angry. But it is what it is, and that's not what we're here to talk about. We're here to talk about the best players and the awards that are going out. Cooper Kupp obviously deserves it. Tyler, I mean, I know that Cooper Kupp's your favorite wide receiver in the NFL right now.
Actually, it's not. It's OBJ.
What? When did that happen?
Well, when he decided to wear number 3, that definitely helped his case. And then he decided to start catching footballs again. That definitely helped his case because he's working with my favorite quarterback. And so, you know, him and Cooper Kupp are neck and neck. But, you know, I feel like Jesse's more of the Cooper Kupp guy.
Yeah, like 100%. He's always been fantasy.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So, I mean, Cooper Kupp, obviously offensive player of the year in my eyes, you know, breaking all the records that he broke. I think he's – I don't know how he's left wide open almost every single game. It's actually ridiculous. But it is what it is, you know. Cooper Kupp, offensive player of the year, hell yeah. Next guy up, Joe Burrow.
Cry your hearts out, Cowboy fans. You were telling me since week fucking 3 that this was my comeback player of the year. Since week 3. That's all I was hearing. And then what happened? Dak Prescott got eliminated round 1, and Joe Burrow decided to go to a fucking Super Bowl. That's tough.
After getting his knee destroyed last year.
Both of them had horrible fucking injuries. I mean, they were both gruesome, and they were both season-ending. But I think
that so basically, whichever one of them did better this year was going to get that.
I think that I mean, Dak did have an amazing year. I'm not taking anything away from him. He tied up franchise record with touchdown passes. Bro went crazy. But I'm just gonna say one thing.
A little controversial.
If you're trying to outplay Joe Shiesty when it comes to voting right now, everybody loves this man. The fans, the NFLPA. There was not a doubt in my mind this man was winning the award. But one thing I just want to talk about real quick, because I watched this and didn't think a single thing of it till I went on Twitter and realized that people were actually making this a big deal. So Joe Burrow got his award. Like they had, you know how normally the Super Bowl teams won't be able to give like press conferences or interviews after they win the award. Well, it was different this time because Cincinnati and everyone was already in LA, so they were able to give speeches and shit. So when Joe Burrow gave his speech, came up, his award was in front of him, he said what he said, he walked away. And he didn't grab his award. And I didn't think that was really anything of it. Until I go on Twitter and half of Twitter is saying he didn't grab it because he only cares about that Super Bowl ring. There's a reason for it. And then the other half of Twitter is going, nah, bro, like, he didn't care about that award, this and that. Maybe he forgot it. Maybe he just forgot to grab it.
Bro, here's the thing. People nowadays love fucking stories for everything.
I know.
If they can slap a good story along with it and it sounds great, they're going to do it. That sounds great for a motivational story to go in the Super Bowl so everyone's attention on it. In reality, this man just went up and just forgot to grab the trophy when he went back to his team when he was done. Everyone's just freaking out over nothing.
I'm like, bro, let Joe be.
Let him be.
See what I did there? Let Joe be.
I do. Anyway. And his partner in crime, Ja'Marr Chase, named Offensive Rookie of the Year. I think we all saw this coming, right?
This wasn't close, and it should
have been. It was not.
But Ja'Marr grabbed his trophy. He did grab
his trophy. He did grab his trophy, yes. No controversy on Twitter with Ja'Marr Chase.
He was the best Offensive Rookie of the Year, and, you know, what's funny is who else was even, like, in the running? Mac Jones?
I think, yeah. Mac Jones was definitely
there.
And there
was one more. I couldn't even think of who it is right now. But like it really wasn't close. I think this was one of the biggest landslides. It wasn't the biggest landslide because I believe the biggest landslide was this award right now.
Yeah, but wait, time out. Just to be clear here, Ja'Marr Chase, 1,455 yards and 13 touchdowns in his rookie year. That's nuts.
Yeah. That is crazy. Now, if Jamar Chase didn't grab his trophy, I would slightly start believing into some conspiracy.
I would, yeah, then I would have a theory on that, Dylan. But, if it was just Joe Burr.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
He's just too iced out to walk around with that comeback trophy when he wants to just get the Najee Lombardi.
Harris. That's who else is in the running.
I also think, just to be clear, I think that if Joe Burrow wins the Super Bowl, he will do something more insane than when Tom Brady threw it on the boat.
Yeah.
I don't know what it will be, but I think he'll do something insane. But Micah Parsons named Defensive Rookie of the Year for the Cowboys. This guy, by the way, thought that he was going to get drafted by the Detroit Lions, but he ended up falling to the Cowboys. And, you know, I think it was well-deserved, Micah Parsons. He had an incredible year.
He is the best linebacker in the NFL right now. I don't give a fuck. And I want to point out something that needs to be talked about a lot more. This is the first time in the history of Defensive Rookie of the Year. It was unanimous. There was no nominees next to bro if you watched the show. It was just Micah Parsons. Every single vote went to him. And I'll tell you right now, it was damn deserved. He's the best linebacker in the NFL right now. He puts pressure on the quarterbacks. He puts pressure on receivers. He puts pressure on running backs. And I think that he's going to be the next Bobby Wagner of some sort for years and years to come. I think Micah Parsons is an unbelievable defensive player.
Oh, definitely. 84 combined tackles, 20 assists, and 13 sacks this season. No interceptions, but
him and Trayvon,
an absolute Diggs, monster.
That's a duo that is going to be around like Wagner and Sherman. That's just me, though. If he keeps picking people off and he keeps fucking putting up his numbers in the linebacker position.
If the Cowboys draft some more defense on this draft, this next upcoming draft, man, they might be a real
crazy
threat.
Though? Remember, not this year, but literally the year before, how all we were shitting about is that they put up 40 points and it still wouldn't be enough because how bad their defense is. You just have two players and the whole thing gets turned around. It's wild. You really only just need one or two players.
Dallas will definitely be a threat next year. I might pick their defense up. I don't know. Fantasy. one more. Or actually, no, two more here still. Mike Vrabel named Coach of the Year. I think this is ironic because he lost to the Bengals, who are now in the Super Bowl. I thought they were going to give this to the Bengals head coach. I'm not going to cap. But Mike Vrabel, Dylan, how do you feel? I know that from a fan standpoint, you're happy about it, but give me your honest thoughts on whether or not you think Mike Vrabel really should have won this award.
Honest thoughts, Mike Vrabel should have won this award because of two reasons. One, he had the best record in the NFL. And two, he did it with, I've said it all year, I'll say it again, it's the most injuries on a team in history. Nobody's had more injuries than the Titans did this season. And you still managed to have the best record in the NFL. That's why he won Coach of the Year. Yes, Zach Taylor is a good coach, but he is not the reason they are as far as they are right now. That is Joe Burrow, and that is Jamar Chase, and he knows that. And I think Mike Vrabel, main reason why he won is not because he had the best record, but it's because of all the setbacks that he had to face throughout the year and still kept that record.
Luke, how do you feel about Mike Vrabel being named Coach of the Year?
You know, I guess it's good for him. He did what he needed to do when shit was hitting the fan with injuries.
I agree.
I do agree. And one more award here. TJ Watt wins Defensive Player of the Year.
Should have 100%. He tied Michael Strahan's record. I thought it was sick as fuck that J.J. Watt was the one presenting the award. You know how they do the little opening, like they'll say one or two sentences before they pronounce the award to get a laugh out of the people there? That was the only one I laughed at because it was really funny when J.J. Watt came out there and the lady next to him, or my bad, not lady, Katie fucking Perry. God, put some respect on her name.
The lady.
I was about to say the lady.
The lady next to him. Perry. Oh, wait, Katie Perry.
It's Katie Perry, and she was like, hey, it's a big deal for you because, you know, you got some family in the award and, you know, J.J. Watt does some, who? She's like, you know, TJ, right in the front row. Oh, you're up for this award, Teach? Congrats, bro. that was pretty funny. And then, you know, he goes on to win the award. And I thought that was cool for the whole Watt family. You see the mom, the dad. The only person I felt bad for was you see mom and dad, and then you see Derek sitting in the middle like, And then the two brothers on the stage walking off with the award. I'm like, damn, bro, that's tough for Derek, the fullback, man. That's tough.
No love. No love. We got to give more love to our fullbacks out here. Shout out, Derek.
Hey, man, Derek Watt is tough, bro.
Shout out, Derek Watt. But that's all we got for the NFL. Next up, we got a little bit of NHL news, just some hometown news, and the puck luck picks coming up next. So, the Red Wings, two-game win streak following the All-Star break. What are the possibilities of the Red Wings going on a Blues type of playoff run?
Well, they're going to need a lot.
Let me hear it. The most extravagant shit you can think of. Just fucking let me hear it, boys.
Well, they're only seven to eight points out of the playoffs, of the wild card spot, I think. I don't know if they are going to be, if they need a tie and they can take that, or if they can win that straight up, or they have to get more points than Boston.
Look, we were in a wild card spot for most of the first half of the year, so I'm not saying that it's impossible, and it is probably possible to go on a streak. Do I think that we're going to go on any crazy run? No. But what I do think is we're going to finish the year over 500. And I just hope to God with the teams around us that it is enough to make the playoffs. Now, I just want to point something out, because I want to point this out, and then I want to ask Tyler. We're not looking for a cup run this year, all right? If it happens, no one's complaining. But that's, you know what I mean? But that's not like what we're really looking for. If we do make the playoffs,
is it really what we're not looking for?
That really just shows if we make the playoffs, then we are already on track of better than anticipated.
Hey, there's enough games to where if we want to, we can.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. There's a possibility, all right? I know we just played the Flyers twice, and that's just hot garbage times two. But, you know, there's a possibility that could help boost the momentum of the boys.
Hey, there's enough games for teams to go win-loss, just every other, and the Wings to go win-win-win-loss. Then just win every other fucking game.
That'd be fucking great. You know,
then France into playoffs and fucking win the cup.
How about that? A man can dream.
Most side are not for Calder, but for Norris. Just saying.
All right. We got puck luck picks coming up next.
Yeah. Oh, get to the grab, it's a must. Speak on the top of my brother's blood. None of these niggas get trust. You cannot question, you know what it was. What was you doing for us? These niggas mad cause I'm putting in work. Like I speak fluent in Russian. Did you catch that?
All right, puck luck picks. Records are shown on the bottom. Snoop Luke leading the way with 61% win percentage so far. The Wanderer, 59%. I'm in third with 56. And Dylan, over the hump of the 500 mark with 51%.
Yeah.
So we got three more puck luck picks coming at you. We got one game still to go as we're recording right now. We're recording on Saturday for Sunday. So we still have one game to go, but the records are shown below. We will give you three picks coming up next. Luke, start us off. Dylan, we'll start with you.
All right.
And let's go through some puck luck picks, boys.
All right, let's get it. How we start?
All right, game one. We have the Edmonton Oilers and the San Jose Sharks, with the Sharks being home Monday night at 10:30 p.m. Eastern.
Saw something on Twitter yesterday that McDavid was pissed. He's not happy with what's going on right now.
Yeah, they've been in a little drought.
Because of the drought. So I'm actually going to take the Sharks. Give me San Jose.
Luke, who do you got in this game?
Well, I have the Oilers in this game. They've been in a little drought. They fired back and won their last game. They're going to keep on rolling into this game and take this dub.
I'm going to have to agree with you, Luke. I'm going to take the Oilers on this game, too. All I'm saying is Connor McDavid is not someone that I'm trying to piss off because he's really good at hockey. So I think the Oilers definitely beat the Sharks in this game. Next game up, Luke, what do we got?
Well, the next game up, we have the Boston Bruins against the New York Rangers, with the Rangers hosting Tuesday at 7 p.m. Eastern.
Give me Boston. I know Brad Marchand suspended, and I hope they win every game that he's suspended for.
Luke, what do you got?
Listen, Boston, even before Marchand got suspended, have been in a little scoring drought. They haven't been pumping in as much goals as they should be, I feel like. Have they been doing through the first stretch of the season? But, you know, the Rangers keep on doing that. Give me the Rangers, especially with Marchand out for the Bruins. Get that menace out of here.
I think that Marchand being out for the Bruins is the main factor in this game. And I think that that's why the Rangers had the advantage. Plus, the Rangers have been playing good hockey this year. So has Boston. But they've been a little shaky in the last 2 weeks of play. Hopefully, you know, the Rangers come out of this All-Star break looking pretty good, because I think they're going to need a lot to take down Boston, but I think they're going to have enough to beat them in this game.
Yes.
Fuck you guys.
One game up. What do you got?
All right. And for the final game, oh boy, do I have a fucking good one. Their records are damn near identical down to the T. We have the Florida Panthers and the Carolina Hurricanes, with the Hurricanes hosting Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. Eastern.
Give me the Canes. Give me the Canes. Go, Canes, go. I want Carolina. Fuck, this is going to be a good game.
Luke, what do you got?
Give me the Florida Panthers.
Kiss my ass.
Oh, Dylan, this is not good. This is no bueno. I'm also taking the Florida Panthers. This is no bueno. Oh, Dylan. Oh, okay. Well, me and Luke are going for the sweep together this week on the Puck Luck Pick. Because I'm taking the Panthers to beat the Canes. Florida is a good team this year. Like, they are probably going to be very, very viable contenders for a cup run. And so I'm going to take the Panthers to beat the Hurricanes. And that'll do it for Puck Luck Picks.
Hey, whoever, I got a hot take. Whoever comes out of the series between Tampa and Florida, they're going to the finals.
Most likely. I'd have to agree with that. Mostly because Tampa just does it every year. But I think that Tampa might be an early exit this year. I think some teams are going to be like, all right, it's fucking, it's been enough. We've had enough. But
like, no,
you never know.
No, I do know.
So, Dylan, you're going to take it away because there's no Jesse today. He is at work. But NBA news, we got some tension in Utah and some trade deadline moves to talk about. So, Dylan, I'll let you take it away.
Rah, 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 rah. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. So, we covered about half the trades that happened at the deadline that were important. Now let's get to the other half. So, starting with the Brooklyn Nets and Philadelphia 76ers, they made a pretty big trade. So, first things first. Ben Simmons, Seth Curry, Andre Drummond, 2022 first-round pick, and an unprotected 2023 first-round pick are going to Brooklyn. What are they sending over to the 76ers? James Harden and Paul Millsap. I think both teams win this trade 100%. From the 76ers side, you have finally a three-point shooter that can help Tyrese Maxey, because Ben Simmons could not shoot a goddamn three. That's going to be James Harden. You also have Embiid, who's making an MVP run, so you don't have any problem with there down in the paint. 76ers are chilling. Then you get a veteran guy, Paul Millsap, who also helped join the squad. No problems there. Over on the Brooklyn side, you have Kyrie, who has had unbelievable amount of bullshit with practice and beef and scuffles and calling Harden washed. And he wanted bro out of there. I'm going to be honest. He wanted to be him and KD, and that's what he got. So now you have him and KD. You have Ben Simmons, who can come in and drive. You have Seth, who can help Joe Harris shoot the three. You still have a great depth of roster for the Nets. So both sides, technically, in my opinion, would get a B or an A on this trade, and it would be great for both sides. That was definitely the biggest trade. But there are other trades to get to. Now, the Dallas Mavericks and the Washington Wizards, they exchanged in a trade, and that includes Spencer Dinwiddie and Davis Bertans going over to Dallas, and Porzingis and a second-round pick going to Washington. This one's a little confusing because I understand from Washington's side, you really don't have a big man after you just traded Montrezl Harrell, who I'll get into in a minute. So you get Kristaps Porzingis. He can shoot the three. He can do the two. I understand that. But I don't understand you getting rid of Spencer Dinwiddie, especially from the Mavericks side, because there goes your big man. Who's going to be my second piece to help Hardaway and Doncic? Dinwiddie? Dinwiddie's a sixth man, bro. He's a good player, but he is not going to be that all-star next level that I think is going to take the Mavericks to the next step. It's a really confusing head-scratcher trade, in my opinion. And if I were to say to anyone who won the trade, I'd give it to the Wizards, to be honest with you. But speaking of that same Wizards team and Montrezl Harrell, he is getting shipped over to Charlotte. He's going to join the Hornets. He's going to join Miles Bridges. He's going to join LaMelo Ball. He's going to join Terry Rozier. And as you can tell, I really like this trade. I think this is good for the Hornets offense. The Hornets have an exciting offense. Now they have another big man who can dunk and play defense. I think that's great for them. They only had to send over Irv Smith and Vernon Carley. I mean, that's really nothing, to be completely honest with you. And to be honest, I wouldn't be surprised if Ish Smith is traded out again in free agency. Or I mean, not free agency, offseason. Because these are pieces that you can just take and use. Smart. I really like this for the Hornets. I will talk about this because this is the final trade. The Pistons, they failed to move Jeremy Grant. He was in talks with the Blazers, then the Lakers, then nothing got shot down. Everything was just nothing for hours. And we're sitting here going, wait, who's going to get traded? Are the Pistons going to do anything at the deadline? And they surprised us by getting a fleece in a four-team trade. Now, there was a four-team trade that happened with Milwaukee, the Clippers, the Pistons, and the Kings. And the big names that happened in that trade were Serge Ibaka fell to the Bucks, and I know the Bucks are happy with that because Ibaka's a great player that can help help their team. I don't have to name anyone on their team. You know the Bucks are a good team. The Clippers got really nobody except for Rodney Hood, and I don't think he's going to do anything with them. So the best team who won the trade, in my opinion, happens to be the team that I'm wearing on my sweatshirt, and that's the Detroit Pistons because we got Marvin Bagley. And we didn't give him shit except for Josh Jackson. And I'll be honest, if you want to get rid of Josh Jackson and give me Marvin Bagley, I'll take that 100%. He's young. He's got a good average of 15 points a game. I know that last year he had a problem with his injuries, and Tyler has brought to me that he does have a lot of injuries for his young career that he's had so far. But I think if this man can stay healthy, you have him, you have Diallo, you have Bistu, you have Sadiq. Because our big man, Sadiq Bey, he just shoots threes now. I got no problem with it, but he's not a big man. So I honestly like this trade a lot because, once again, you're doing two things. You're getting a piece that we need, and you're keeping our core young. Those are the two things I really can't complain about at all. And when it comes down to the trade deadline, those are all the trades that happen. So let's bring the boys back in now. Or else... They just deal with all the ice on in the boat. At the gate outside, when they pull up, they give me loose. Yeah, jump out for us, that's like he was hopping our boots. This shit way too big, when we pull up, give me the loot. Was off the Remy, had him back loose. Had to hit my whole town, there's nothing loose. Just go out of lockdown, we made no moves. Now it's counting him, and I'm back up popping with the crew. I just landed in, Chase B mixes pop like Jamba Joe's. Different color chains, think my jewelry really.
Alrighty, let's get into it. Downtown Cash Picks. Sunday, February 13th, we have the Timberwolves taking on the Pacers.
Hijacked my picks?
Whoa.
Damn, that's kind of fucked.
I didn't know you had any.
I always do. I have them on my phone and I do it on the pods. We've been doing them for 2 weeks.
You got them for Sunday?
Yeah, I got a 2 o'clock game, the next day a 10 o'clock game, the next day an 8 o'clock game.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, 2 o'clock Sunday, Hawks, Celtics.
Will it be posted up before 2? That's why I didn't pick the 2 o'clock hockey games on Sunday.
For sure. Hawks and Celtics.
Fine. You want to do the Sunday game? You can do the Sunday game, but give me the other two. What's your Sunday game, Tom?
Dylan, Hawks and Celtics or Timberwolves and Pacers?
Okay, we'll do Timberwolves and Pacers because Luke doesn't want to do the 2 o'clock game.
No, I just told you what Tell I did for hockey.
I just said I understand.
It ain't this hard.
I just
Hawks and Celtics then. Jesus.
Okay, fuck it, yeah. Hawks and Celtics in Boston. Luke, who you got?
Boston.
Every time.
Of course he has Boston. Ty, who you got?
When it comes to this game, I'm gonna go with Boston. I think they've been playing better basketball than the Hawks recently, so I'm gonna take Boston as well.
I mean, the way that this podcast has been going today, it makes sense that I would just continue to fade both of your guys' fucking picks because I'm being too one at everything. I'm taking the Hawks. I'm taking Trae Young to play villain role in Boston, and Tatum has been having a really weird year, and I think he's going to have an off night. I don't know. I'm taking Trae Young, and I'm taking the Hawks.
Okay. Well, anyways, the next game now.
Monday, 10:30. The new and improved Los Angeles Clippers are playing host to the 41-15 Golden State Warriors.
Well, you already know I'm taking Steph Curry and the Warriors because I love them. So I'm taking Steph, Chef Bleff Curry.
I have to agree. I got to take the Warriors on this one just because Steph Curry, Klay Thompson. Do I have to say anything else? I don't think I do.
No. I'm okay with that completely.
Luke?
Ooh, this has put me in a tough position because the home and road record favor the Clippers.
This man and his home and away records.
That's impossible. The Warriors have 15 losses. The Clippers have 27 wins. I mean, I don't.
Okay, well, technically they're identical, the road and their home, but, you know. It's okay. Fuck it. I'm going Warriors.
Okay.
Final game, Tuesday night, 8 o'clock. This is basically how Luke's final game was. Similar records, only off by one game. Charlotte Hornets going to Minnesota to play the Timberwolves.
Ooh.
Yeah, it's going to be a tough one.
This is a tough one. I'm going to take the Hornets, though. I'm going to do it. I'm gonna take the Hornets. I like the way they're looking. I like the new pieces. I like everything about it. I think they got a really good shot at winning this game against the Timberwolves. I think it'll be a high scoring game though, but I'm taking the Hornets.
I agree. The Charlotte Hornets lead the NBA in scoring. They put up points and they know how to do it well. You just added another factor in Montrezl Harrell, who can also put up points, and I think they should win this game too.
Hey, all I'm saying is, according to the records, Charlotte's better on the road than they are at home. So, give me the Charlotte Hornets.
Bro said,
I don't know why you had to say it like that.
N-E-T-S. He said Hornets.
How to get that full pronunciation in, Dylan? Don't you understand? Well, those are the downtown cash picks. Current records are below Jesse and McDilly, 52% apiece. I'm at 52% as well. And fuck. Snoop Luke at 45%. So
I'm still creeping.
It's anybody's game. It's really anybody's game.
Hey, I'm on track to go back to back sweeps later tonight at 7:30.
Okay, we'll see about that. All right. We'll see about that. So
that percentage is going to be improved by next podcast greatly.
So the final thing we have on today's podcast, your Super Bowl winner outright and your MVP, starting with Dylan, and then we'll wrap up this podcast. Dylan, your Super Bowl winning team and your Super Bowl MVP.
You know, there's never anything more Detroit than I've said than this, but I'm going to have to say the Los Angeles Rams will win this Super Bowl. I really, really don't think it's going to be as close as everyone is making it out to be. I think that they will win by more than a touchdown. I'm not going to give a score prediction, but that's all I will say. And I will say the MVP of the game should be Stafford, but for whatever reason, they're going to rob him and not give it to him, and probably someone like Cooper Kupp or OBJ. That's what I honestly think is going to happen. I think Stafford should get MVP and he won't.
Okay, here's the thing. From previous years in the Super Bowl, everyone's expecting this game just to not be a big scoring game because Super Bowls aren't that big scoring. But here's the thing. This year, we got some nice new fresh teams in there. They're about to be banging. They're going to be putting up hella points. Both teams are going to be over 25 points. Possibly 30. This game might see overtime. That would be insane. But give me the Rams. Probably Stafford's going to win the MVP if the Rams win. I'm being honest.
You know, I didn't think it would be like this, but if I would have went first, you would have known that I'm taking Matthew Stafford for MVP and the Rams to win the Super Bowl. So apparently we're all on the same page when it comes to that that pick. So I'm also taking Matthew Stafford and the Rams.
No, I'm kidding.
I mean, it could be Aaron Donald. It very well could be.
10 sacks on Joe Burrow.
Joe Burrow, I mean, he's on his back all game. They might give it to him. So are you going to take Aaron Donald? Do you want to change it?
Give me Aaron Donald, the 10 sacks on Joe Burrow.
Yep. 10 sacks by himself? Nuts.
Yep, he's going to have a game.
I mean, that's a hell of a game. That's even though like record-breaking.
It's going to be an absolute shootout, so he can't get sacked 10 times. But, you know.
Contradicting picks, but, you know, pick what you want.
My final thing that I just want to point out, because I watched it and I need to say something about it, is the NFL Honors NFL Man of the Year Award did go to Andrew Whitworth. He is an offensive lineman, the oldest offensive lineman in the NFL who plays for the Los Angeles Rams. Big shout out for everything that he has done in his community and around outside the NFL. Walter Payton Man of the Year Award, honestly, to me, that's bigger than the MVP, because that is not only what you do on the field, but that's what you do off the field, and that's, you know, more important.
Well, now he's got to go win a ring.
So I'm just saying, the only thing that can finish that is him going to win a ring. And last thing, apparently Odell Beckham Jr.'s kid is supposed to be born during the Super Bowl. So I'm telling you right now, she better push that baby in. She better do all she can, man. Because if that
suck it back in, yeah. No, not yet.
Odell leaves during the third quarter, I'm gonna be pissed.
Yeah, I'm gonna lose my mind. OBJ, anytime touchdown score. If you need some Super Bowl bets, I'm sure Vegas Sports Advantage will be happy to provide those to you. Make sure that you click the link in our description. Find Vegas Sports Advantage. Go to their website, VegasSportsAdvantage.com. Get yourself some picks. Buy a pick package today and make sure that your Super Bowl bets are ready. Maybe you can follow along with our same game parlay bets if you like those. If not, that's fine. Go to VegasSportsAdvantage.com. Make the right decision. Get those Super Bowl bets in. If you want to bet on the coin toss, they got coin toss bets, I'm sure. I've been getting so many Super Bowl bets after I got a package from Vegas Sports Advantage. It has done very well. They have not lost any money in any sport all year, this year or last year, and it's amazing. Vegas Sports Advantage, check it out. Make sure you guys also hit up Six Pack Coverage to find all of our episodes. Check it out on YouTube, Six Pack Coverage on YouTube, sixpackcoverage.com. They got merch available. Hit it up now. Get it while it's hot because it sells out super quick. We're growing insanely fast, Six-Pack Coverage. Check us out online. We'll see you guys after the Super Bowl, after the Rams win. We'll see you guys on Wednesday.
Yes, sir.
So we'll see you guys on Wednesday. Thursday. We'll see you guys on Thursday.
Thursday.
UFC talk on Thursday. We're going to recap 271. I know that just happened, but UFC 271, we're going to recap that on Thursday as well as the Super Bowl and any other news that we have for you guys. So until next time, ride the tide. We'll catch you guys on the flip
Thursday.
It's your place or it's my soul.